The following is paid programming.
Something More with Chris Boyd, Certified Financial Planner Professional. Your fulfillment facilitator.
Help me help you. Help me help you. Help me help you.
Your partner in prosperity.
Show me the money!
Derek, you better yell!
Show me the money!
Advising clients across the country. Here he is, your host, J. Christopher Boyd.
All right, welcome. This is Something More with Chris Boyd. I'm Chris Boyd, Certified Financial Planner Practitioner, and my office is Asset Management Resources. Our firm is a registered investment advisor firm, and we call our show Something More because we like to talk about not only those important dollar and cents issues, but also those quality of life issues that make the money matters matter. Thanks for being with us today. We're going to be joined by Jeff Perry as my co-host throughout the day today. Thank you. Jeff,
good afternoon, Chris. Happy to be here.
You've been filling in for me lately, so thank you for that as well.
You've been a busy guy. So,
well, we've had some activity that has caused me to have conflicts. So, I appreciate you being able to step in. So, appreciate that. And it's been a busy time. We're like well into the holiday season.
It's a busy time for everybody this time of year.
Yeah, it's amazing. It's amazing. And, but it's good to have that time and, good to be busy, right? Better than, not, right?
I think most people like to, it's a balance, right?
Yeah.
Especially this time of year, you get a lot of things to do, a lot of invitations, a lot of tasks, and you can feel a bit overwhelmed. So it's a balance.
Right. Joining us, this segment, we've got Cathi Ingersoll, our marketing director on the line. Hey, Cathi.
Hi, Chris. Hi, Jeff.
Thanks for being with us this segment. We have a lot of things to go over, but I want to give everyone a little sense of the show today. We're gonna we had some guests lined up, but it turns out it's cold season too. People aren't feeling good, so things happen. We'll reschedule. And look forward to having those conversations another time. We do have plenty of things to talk about, though, that are portfolio related, market related, personal finance. So we're going to talk not only with Brian Regan during the show and about what's some of the market related topics. And then, Jeff, you and I are probably going to talk a little bit about something you thought would be an interesting discussion. There's been some controversy around ESG investing where it's sort of the pendulum swinging, right? Where there's been this great enthusiasm around ESG over the last several years. There seems to be a little bit of a pushback on some of that.
Yeah, I'm going to call it some of it's political. So, you got to discount that. But some of it is kind of unintended consequences, like people stepped into the topic for good reasons, but when you get into the nuts and bolts, I think there's some problems or concerns that people have that are worth talking about.
Yeah, so we'll talk a little bit about those kind of things. And of course, there is the year end when people talk about a Santa Claus rally. We'll get a chance to, investigate. Is this a real thing? Is this something we should be benefiting from?
It sounds good.
Yeah, it's absolutely a good thing. So before we jump into all these different things we're going to talk about, I thought it was worth, we were talking and doing some planning the other day, on our show, as we look ahead to the next year and planning in the next month or so. I thought it was worth reiterating, a little bit about some of what our show, is ultimately about. And, one of the things that we try to do, we call it Something More. Because it's important not only that, we do the Something More, some aspects of the show to help you make a little something more every week, right? There's always things right. about your personal finance. There's topics about what's happening in the markets and how to navigate some of these kind of things. But, you know, and something more is also, I wanted the flexibility originally when we created the show to be able to talk about other things, you know, not just the financial. And ultimately, you know, I think one of the dangers we have when a lot of the, our society, we, I don't know, at least the people that probably listen to this station and the people I know, the people like me, we tend to be news junkies. We're constantly consuming, you know, news content.
Probably too much.
And sometimes, and political talk, right?
Right. Yep.
And sometimes it's, it can be somewhat negative. It's us versus them.
Sometimes.
It's far too often. Right. It's negative and antagonistic and, you know, trying to point the finger at that's the reason and get people motivated for change and, you know, that kind of thing. It's intended to antagonize a little bit, get people riled up. And want to, you know, move an agenda, right?
Right. Yeah.
And that's all fine and good. But so one of the things that I try to think about, I always want our show to be constructive. Now, I don't know if we've always achieved that objective, but my intention is to have the show be something that is positive and ultimately, you know, something that gives people constructive content. And a force for good, if you will.
Yeah, educational as well, right?
Educational, entertaining, but, you know, something that is ultimately positive. And one of the things that I think in talking about personal finance that becomes important is to recognize that this is a tool. It is not the end. When we talk about something more, we're talking about not just what we talk about. We say, you know, fulfillment facilitators at the start of the show. I think that's really important to keep in mind. You know, it's not just about trying to accumulate more, although that's certainly part of what we're trying to help people do, to create wealth, to have financial independence, to have security, if you will. And of course, securities, you know, that kind of thing. Right. But there's also this point of keeping in mind, what's it all about? It's not just about stuff. It's or wealth for wealth's sake. It's about fulfillment. What's our life? What gives our life meaning? What's important to us? And for most people, you know, that connects to other people. It's about relationships, community. And we have lots of charities on this time of year. That's part of why we're trying to facilitate community and make a difference, have impact where there's a need for resources or whatever it might be. So, you know, I think it's worth, especially this time of year, you know, when we think a lot about the holidays and there's a certain enthusiasm and I don't know, a warmth of the holidays that people enjoy.
Yes.
I like to, you know, who doesn't enjoy that? But I think, you know, it's important to kind of keep remembering, what's it all about? And wealth and financial resources are important. They provide us opportunities for, you know, our objectives, our ends, our a simpler, a happier life in some respects. Not always simpler, but you know what I mean. We're not struggling. It's hard, you know, when you're not struggling, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It is simpler.
Yeah, but at the same time, I mean, it can get complicated when you have, you know, lots of resources or whatever. but ultimately, you know, keep that in mind. What's it all about? It's about, you know, maybe relationships, people, community, whatever that may be for you. And ultimately, that's what we're trying to help with. That's something more. So in any case, that's kind of what I wanted to start off the show with, a little bit of a reflection on what are we trying to do? We try to provide you a lot of information, a lot of news, a lot of content, and great guests and great, you know, insights, and, team members who provide that and so forth. So, yeah, Cathy, go ahead.
Oh, I just wanted to add because, you know, I just love that whole thought of something more. You know, like you said, we help people with their financial planning. And of course, everybody needs money to cover the basic necessities of life, right? Yeah. Shelter, food, et cetera. But we want, you know, I think most people would rather thrive than just survive, right? They want to,
well said,
you know, live your best life. And in order to do that, you've got to have, this is Jeff's favorite topic, you've got to have goals, right? To live your best life.
Yes, you do need goals.
Goals and budgets are for Jeff's favorite topics, right?
You don't want to, you know, be at 90 years old and discover that you never got to climb Mount Everest because it wasn't in your plan. You know, your days go by and you don't achieve what your life goals are. But, you know, that is just what our Something More is all about, right? You want to live your best life. And, you know, financial planning in many regards can help you do that. But I also would say that living your best life or your something more can change depending on where you are in your life and what your circumstances are.
Very true.
For some people nearing retirement, it might be just like you said, might be spending time with their family or going out for a daily walk or enjoying the beauty of the landscape. For other people, it might be as aggressive as climbing Mount Everest or traveling the world or whatnot. But you've gotta take time and think about what your something more is so that you really can live your best life.
And sometimes having some help in that effort to, you know, we find a lot of times people come in and you ask them some, you know, questions about goals and it's hard for people to articulate sometimes what do they really want? What is important to them? And then, you know, you get into a conversation and it starts to unfold, but it's not something we necessarily always have at the tip of our tongue. And so sometimes it can be helpful to have someone assist in that conversation and then to try to figure out, you know, well, how do I accomplish that? What do I need to be able to do that? What's it take? How do, you know, we were talking about this a lot of times people want to know what's my number,
right?
You know, you know, how much do I need?
A bit more than a number.
Yeah, exactly. But that's often the way people think about, what, you know, they want a goal. What's my goal? What's my number? What do I need to get to? And so that I can then, okay, now I've reached my number, you know, that kind of thing.
Chris, I'm really glad you're doing this segment. I mean, we didn't know we were doing this segment until a few minutes before we went on air.
Yeah.
And I want to share something with you and get your comment on it. I always viewed the name of the show, which I think is brilliant for the reasons you articulated, and something I haven't shared. So I always thought the name of the show was directly an offshoot of the financial planning business, because when you're a client of Asset Management Resources, as you started to talk about, it's more than just the investing, it's more than just the portfolio management. It's all those things plus, as Cathy was saying, life goals and having a trusted advisor and a fiduciary, someone looking out for you. That's where I thought the something more came from. I thought it came from the practice of the concept of we're something more than just, I don't want to say just a financial advisor, I'll say that. And you translated it to the show. Was that the motivation or am I just?
No, that's a great point. That wasn't actually my intent at the time.
I thought it was.
But I think that's a very apt, you know, it is, you know, when you're dealing with a financial professional, it's important, yes, that they, you know, be a good portfolio manager or whatever it might be. But you know, it is really important that there's these other aspects that they're looking at. It's, you know, financial planning, which, you know, we characterize ourselves as financial planners, is a lot more than just portfolio management.
Especially, you know, today. I mean, today there's robots doing it, right?
Yeah.
I mean, they call them robots, and you can pay a little fee and you get an automated thing. And, you know, here's my age, here's how much money I have, and there's my plan. And that's, really simplistic, and maybe it's worked for some people, but it's really not in the best interest of someone to
look
at things that simply, or not realize the benefits of working with a fiduciary, a financial advisor, and all the other things that come along, those something more things.
Yeah, it's true. It's a good point, Jeff. Actually, you know, early in the show, we decided, well, you know, the inspiration for the name was really the song that we used as part of our show open, and the idea that there's got to be something more. It's not, you know, in this scenario, it's things about the struggles of a daily, you know, work right. that, you know, it's not fulfilling. Right. And yep. so what we've done segments over the years with people that we called them something more segments, with people who have opted to maybe leave their well-paying job for something that's a passion,
yes.
For a more fulfilling kind of, option.
That's the word again. Right?
Yeah. Yep. And so, I think that's, you know, been a consistent thought process about, you know, when we talk about something more, you know, so lots of ways you can interpret that. But in any case, you know, before we wind down this segment, thank you both for your, you know, contributions on that. You know, we want to thank everyone for our clients and, participants who, our employees who shared in the Toys for Tots drive that we did. Cathy, you probably could talk a little bit about it. You were sort of the driver behind our decision to jump on board with this as part of our planning this winter.
Sure. You know, what I liked about it, Chris, one is, we not only were able to give to children who, you know, to maybe help make their holiday a little magical. We remember when we were all young children, how special maybe the holidays could be for us, but they're not as special if you don't have some means of providing. Mm. And so I think Toys for Tots, the U.S. Marine Corps Toys for Tots program, every year does that. I think on Cape Cod last year, there was something in the neighborhood of 45,000 toys gathered for almost a little over 19,000 children. And we served as a drop-off location for Toys for Tots this year. Our Hyannis office did, but we also partnered with our clients, and it was a fun way to work together with our clients to do something good for the community.
People are so generous. It's so nice, you know, and people have the
We had great participation from everyone. And we also, you know, just to add a little more excitement to it, we entered our clients into a drawing for a $100 Trader Joe's gift card, and happy to announce that Glenn and Linda Bollinger were the recipients of that gift card.
Oh,
so thank
exciting.
You to them and to all of our clients and our team members, like you said, Chris, who participated.
Absolutely.
Chris, did I see on social media on our Facebook page that you actually delivered the toys to the Stuff-A-Bus?
We did.
Matthews?
We brought it down to the Stuff-A-Bus while they were doing the whole, you know, drive through the radio station. You know, Kevin has, I lost track of how many years it's been.
27.
Thank you. 27 years. And he deflects and says, oh, you know, it's all of you and everyone who's, you know, and it is a big community effort, of course, but, you know, big pat on the back to, Kevin
Absolutely.
Matthews and his continued efforts to try to, you know, the impact that he's had through, rallying the community behind this effort. And,
And, we had him on one of the weeks that you were off.
Yes, and, I did hear that segment. Yeah,
27 years, and he still has that elevated level of excitement and enthusiasm. So
yeah,
I agree. Kudos to Kevin.
Yeah, so.
It's such a great thing. And I should clarify too that the Stuff-A-Bus that that Kevin Matthews from iHeart does, all those toys do get provided to Toys for Tots.
That's right.
So
it's Toys for
Tots. We were a drop-off location at our Hyannis office. We contributed to what Kevin took from many people in the community to the local Toys for Tots drive.
Right, Right.
And Kevin would want us to say that all the toys donated stay on Cape Cod.
Correct. Yes. Yep.
So it's not too late. I'm sure there's other opportunities if people want to help participate in the Toys for Tots program. In any case, let's take a break and come back with more financial talk. Thanks for being with us this segment, Cathy. We'll be back with more financial talk right after this. Stay with us. Welcome back to Something More with Chris Boyd. So, well, Jeff, you know, I mean, we were just talking about all the fulfillment stuff, and now we're going to get right into the number stuff.
Well, that's part of it too, right? Yeah, I mean, I think most people, just not to stay on the subject too long, but I think most people listen to the show, and I did before, you know, before I knew you, right? I was a listener. Yeah. I listened because I wanted insight on investing economic issues locally. And so that's why I tuned in. And, you know, everybody has a different reason to tune in. You know, when Brian's on, I'm sure there's part of the audience that's super engaged and listening to every word. And then when we have certain guests, I had the sheriff on last week, which was an excellent interview. Yeah, I'm sure people were interested by that. And some others, people are saying, why do you have this guest on? I want to know about the numbers, right? So,
But I do hear from people who say, I really like those something more or the those other things, like they like the engagement with things that when we go, you know, outside the purely financial too, you know,
I actually got feedback this past week from someone who I was talking about on a business related issue that gave me feedback to the sheriff's interview. It was very positive feedback and said something exactly like that, that they liked the variety.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Everybody's different.
Yeah. That was a great interview. I really enjoyed it. You obviously had, you know, have a unique perspective to bring to that conversation. The sheriff is so humble.
But, I know.
But he did a nice job. It was fun to hear about.
I knew he wouldn't mention the organized crime stuff that he worked in undercover for years. So, I mean, he's got some stories. I knew he wouldn't even mention it unless I somehow teased it out, and then he just, you know, he is so humble, and that's what's made him special over these last 45 years, but 24 years as sheriff. It's that interview, if people haven't heard it, is certainly posted as a podcast, but it's also on our social media outlets, Twitter, LinkedIn, Facebook, and I posted it on mine as well. So if they want to hear it, it's out there on our social media.
Yeah, check that out. You can find us through Something More with Chris Boyd on all kinds of venues, whether it's Facebook, LinkedIn, Twitter, Instagram, etc. You can also find an asset management resources page for many of those same locations. In any case, and you know, if you don't get a chance to listen to the radio show each week on WXDK, please follow us on your favorite podcast provider. We're on iTunes, Spotify, iHeart, of course, and many others. So we were going to talk a little bit about some of the jobs story. You know,
there's a lot of the news.
The Federal Reserve has been in an effort to slow the economy, and one of the key points that people are paying attention to our jobs, because we've had such a tight labor market where there's so many jobs. Jobs are bountiful and plentiful, and not enough workers to fill all the jobs we've got. So, you know, one of the things that people are watching is there a change in employment? And of course, that also factors into the Fed's efforts to fight inflation. If there's a harder economic environment, inflation would likely tamp down. So we've had some good news along those lines when it comes to the inflation seems to be starting to ease a little bit. And it's still, you know, still higher than we want it to be, but it's, you know, the rate of ascent is slowing, it appears. Tell us a little bit about how this fits into the context with employment.
I will. I want to say one thing that's interesting, and I think people are getting confused, because when a bad number comes out, and so a concerning number came out this week for continuing unemployment claims, and I'll get into those numbers in a second.
Yeah.
But that's viewed right now as good news by the markets for the reasons that you articulated with. So I think it's confusing for the casual, if you will, investor or citizen when they see bad news and they see people happy about it, or really good news, you know, really good economic news is bad because the Fed is going to, the Fed's going to say we have to keep tightening. And so it is a bit counterintuitive the way to think about it.
Yeah. A little baffling. Yeah.
So we got some bad news on unemployment this week, which might be good news.
Yeah.
And so the bad news is on the unemployment is that the continuing claims, those are the ongoing claims. People are on unemployment for long periods of time, was up 62,000 above expectations to about 1.7 million people. And that 1.7 million level is the highest since February. So in essence, to your point, Chris, the Fed trying to slow the economy down, more people continuing to be on unemployment is a sign that they're slowing it down, right?
Right.
And in, also in the news, the initial jobless claims for this week was up just a little bit. It's traveling around $230,000 people a week, which is a higher level than it had been. And we're seeing lots of companies in the news. And this is, I'd like your comments on this after I kind of lay out some examples, because we hear about Twitter, Amazon, Citicorp, Intel, Microsoft, J&J, Wells Fargo. I have a whole list here. It's a long list. I'm not going to read it all, but a lot of companies, a lot of tech companies for sure, but a lot of companies across the board are either on hiring freezes or laying people off. So that fits into the rising unemployment trend. And this is what seems a bit odd. On the street, if you will, meaning Main Street, we're seeing companies not able to hire people. I mean, just the last couple of weeks ago, a restaurant in Wareham that my family had visited forever, Lindsay's, and my mother's favorite restaurant for sure when she was alive, closed. And they were not, I mean, I haven't been there in a year or so, but they were not suffering for business, and they just squarely put it out there that they can't find employees to do a good job.
That's rough.
You know, we see the closed Monday and Tuesday, lack of help. We see all the help wanted signs. So I don't know. Maybe we have two different economies here. Maybe we have a economy with the tech businesses who are more sensitive to higher interest rates are slowing down their hiring or laying people off. But the people on Cape Cod, the employers on Cape Cod, and the employers here in Florida where I am, I don't think they're seeing the same thing.
What do you think they're seeing?
I think they're seeing a struggle to find employees.
Yeah.
So, meaning,
but that does have economic consequence it does. As well. If you have the opportunity to create more output, but can't because of a lack of employment options, you know, not enough people to fill those jobs, it has a slowing effect, right?
That's right.
You're going to make less money as a business owner or whatever it might be, you know.
Or you have to, the same result, but some of it you have to pay people. You see, we were in a mall for doing some Christmas shopping, and at the food court, there were signs up, you know, like hiring, starting $20 an hour.
Yeah.
I mean, that it all translates back to the customer, right?
Yeah.
Absolutely. I went to Subway and got a $5 footlong that was $8. I mean,
yeah, it's inflation at its worst.
Right.
Yeah.
It's
but I mean, in reality, if it costs that much more to make the sandwich, you know, because you know, not only the employment costs, but you know, when it comes to the food and you know, so everything, you know, the materials going into your $5 foot long is $8, you know, that's like, I guess you get it. But, so it's, I mean, that's in a nutshell what we're dealing with the problems. And so if they can slow the economy, sadly, there'll be more people out of work looking for work and, you know, there'll be fewer economic, it just slows the whole process down. And
I guess I agree with everything you're saying, but I guess maybe the point I wasn't articulate about is it's almost as if there is developing potentially two different employment situations with the higher paid, say tech business, and the higher, you know, the white collar jobs perhaps are seeing layoffs, where the lower end of the wage scale is seeing demand for employees. I'm not sure that these higher end jobs that are, you know, I listed some of the companies where they're announcing layoffs, and layoffs, that's part of the continuing claims and the higher initial claims on the data. But I don't think that translates into more workers for service type jobs.
Yeah. Yeah. There's definitely, you know, and Jeff, there's always a diversion in, you know, both ends of the spectrum. It's usually that higher education provides for greater job security, and that it's the people with less education and lesser, you know, pay scale, that they have less job security. This may be an anomaly. It seems like you're saying it's sort of the opposite right now, but
back to what people see, you know, like the bad news, good news thing, right?
Yeah.
It may not, they see layoffs on the news and the unemployment rate continuing claims being above expectations, which is what the Fed's trying to do. But when they're driving around, doing their shopping, doing their eating, you know, trying to hire a landscaper or a tradesman, it's, I need help, right?
Yeah. Well, so, you know, and I think some of this too is, you know, all these things are cyclical in nature, right? So, you know, in the case of whether it's technology today or something else, you know, there's industries that go through expansion and excess, and then they have, you know, shrinkage, you know, the cutback. And then, you know, right now, you know, people are dying to get some renovations and all that. But, you know, we go through booms and busts in these cycles as well. You know what I mean?
For sure.
You know, it gets excessive. And then there's more people in those trades, and then there's fewer opportunities. You know, so you kind of go through these, seems like inevitably.
For sure.
Well, that was a little grim. Sorry. In any case, you know, I think the point ultimately here is that, you know, we're starting to see the impacts of this higher interest rate environment. It's you know, there are certain industries that are more sensitive to it right now.
Technology being one of them.
Right. And we're probably going to have, you know, that kind of a mindset. You know, Brian will talk about it from the point of view of, you know, are these companies attractive and will they continue to be profitable, you know, as an investment opportunity kind of mindset, which may be different from, you know, someone who's an employee and what they're going to have to go through. You know
right.
what I mean? Or... You follow me. Anyway.
I do. And there's one more piece of data on the employment front that I just want to bring up and get your thoughts is the participation rate. You know, when before COVID, the participation rate, meaning the number of people who are work age, who are participating in the labor force, was much higher than it is today. So it certainly, we understand why it went down during COVID.
Yeah. It's had some rebound, but we haven't gotten back to the same level, right? So, I mean, some of that, we were on a trend anyway, right? Where there's a demographic aspect of this. And so I think that's an element of it, that there's just, we've got the baby boomer bubble, an aging demographic, and that's going to factor into some of this. Do you have an alternative like mindset about the workforce participation rate that there's, I think, you know, people think, oh, is there people are incentivized to stay home. There's, you know, too much in the way of, you know, benefits for unemployment or something. I don't really think that right now. I don't think that, you know, that might've been the case, where there was, you know, an abundance of resources in the midst of the pandemic.
I think that's also a trend.
I don't think that's the case.
I don't think it's a significant trend, but I think there's a certain number of our younger population that just hasn't entered the labor participation
Yeah, that's possible.
Numbers. And I mean, it could be because they're living at home. It could be, you know, there's a million reasons.
It could be, for example, they took a gap year and they're behind schedule on their degree. You know, it could be during the pandemic. It could be things like people started during the pandemic, decided I'm going to get a graduate degree instead of, you know, in the midst of these circumstances or whatever it might be.
Those are all positive reasons.
Things like that could throw some aspect of the numbers. I think you also have the reality that people who, you know, decided I don't want to be a nurse anymore, I'm going to retire because of the, you know, just I'm burnt out from all this.
We saw that, you know, too.
Kind of stuff. The medical profession, the education profession, there's lots of, you know, examples you can point to and say there's been some police, you know, been some, you know, a increased level of retirements that,
yep,
you know, could factor into some of these kinds of things where people said, all right, I'm just doing it now instead of later. And so, you know, on both ends of the spectrum, I think you could point to some ideas as to what might drive some of these reasons for the participation rate to be a little bit sub.
On the negative side of that too, I think two other factors. One is COVID. I think some of the maybe older people who are still in the labor force, part-time or whatever you want to call it, semi-retired, chose not to work during COVID and have chosen not to go back to work because of COVID concerns. And on the other end of the age spectrum is just sadly, you know, we see it on the news with the stories with the border, and everyone probably knows someone who has suffered from an addiction problem. And, you know, a lot of people have passed away or are still suffering from active addictions, and they're certainly not in the labor force. So there's a lot of factors. But the fact is we have less, the labor participation number is less than it was pre-COVID, which adds to this lack of employees overall.
Yeah. All right. Let's take a break. We got another segment this hour. We want to talk about some more topics. Maybe we'll start the discussion on ESG. I don't know if we'll get through it, but we'll get into it and get started. Stay with us. More to come.
It's the most wonderful time of the year.
Welcome back to Something More with Chris Boyd. I'm Chris Boyd, certified financial planner practitioner. I'm here with Jeff Perry. He is an investment advisory representative with our firm as well. And we welcome you to reach out if at any time you have needs for your financial planning or portfolio management. You can find us through our website, amrfinancial.com, AMR for Asset Management Resources. And we'd love to have an opportunity to meet with you. As we look ahead, we are, you know, thinking we'll probably do our complimentary portfolio review program that we often do at the start of the year or the turn of the year. So keep an ear out for that over the next couple weeks. But if you have an interest, don't hesitate to reach out. We'll certainly be happy to talk to you. In any case, amrfinancial.com or 508-771-8900, toll-free 866-771-8901. Jeff, you had pointed out to me that maybe we should talk a little bit about the ESG topics. Let's just start with, for those who don't know, there's been a movement within investing to pay attention to certain considerations as part of, in addition to trying to think about, oh, I want to buy a good company or whatever, there are some people who want to be paying attention to other priorities in the way they go about doing their investing. Environmental concerns, maybe that's about carbon or, you know, things like that. Maybe there's social concerns. Oh, what's the makeup of that board? Does this company embrace, you know, diversity as an example? And governance, which I think all investors care about the quality of the governance of a company. You know, are they ultimately practicing, you know, good disciplines in the way they manage the company. So in any case, there's probably a variety of other things that you could kind of point to that. But in any case, and I've kind of maybe simplified it, oversimplified it, but in any case, ESG investing has become a very popular consideration for many companies and investors. Mutual fund companies, ETF investment companies have talked about this more. I think in the face of thoughts about global climate change. People are concerned about that in the aftermath of, you know, inequities in race that have been focused on quite a bit over the last 5 years.
I think I'm going to use a broad term, but any social issue can be someone's ESG, right? I mean, it can be.
Yeah, I think these have been the focal points primarily, right?
Oh, I think there's been discussion around gun manufacturers, certainly energy producers, as you said. I think
there's also social and religious values kinds of considerations.
For sure.
That, you know, there are some investment offerings that have been around. This has been around for a long time where they design their portfolio around certain values. But ESG may be some of those funds get encompassed in that in ESG, or they could be very specific for their own, you know, religious and social priorities. And so it can, but it doesn't always, right? But to your point, Jeff, one person's vice is another person's virtue, and you can get very challenging. How do we think about that, right? So in any case,
Long before these mutual fund or whatever companies, whoever's developing EFTs, ETFs, whatever it is, created these ESG funds, if you will,
all these letters.
Yeah. Before these products were available.
Yeah.
Individuals did it on their own.
Yes. Yeah.
Right. I'm not investing in this company because, or I'm investing in this company because.
Yeah. Yeah. And you know, when there've been shootings or something, to your point, you know, we've had clients call up and say, I want to make sure I'm not investing in gun manufacturers or ammunition, you know, companies. Some people in their course of their investing, and we don't run into this as much, where people say, I don't want to include, say, military defense, you know, companies, or I don't want to include alcohol and tobacco companies, or I don't want to include, you know, fill in the blank, right? And on the other side of it, we've had clients say, hey, this marijuana change in, you know, direction societally, maybe there's a way we can benefit from that as investors. Yeah. I want, you know, so there's both sides of this, right?
All over the place, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
I guess that's the point, right?
Yeah. So in any case, there's been a move within investment world to recognize this as this ESG, this thing, prioritizing environmental, social, and governance as an additional layer of consideration in the investments one might choose. And that's maybe the setup for some of the things you want to talk about. BlackRock, iShares, a company that owns iShares, their leader has been outspoken in saying, we're going to adopt some of these priorities in the way we think about some of our investment decisions, right? There have been others. And you're saying, you know, maybe there's a little bit of I'm calling it a pendulum swing, but this idea that there's also some blowback to some of this stuff where people saying, maybe that's not always what we want, as an example.
Well, the blowback has been variable, certainly. It's coming from different points of view, and some of these are political in nature, as I suggested. For good or bad, I'm not making a value judgment on that. Some of the stories that's been in the news recently, just the past couple of weeks, is Florida, my home state now. Governor DeSantis has said clearly that he's pulling the pension money that was with BlackRock, $2 billion, out of their investing with BlackRock because of BlackRock's comments that you summarized regarding ESG. And so, I mean, you can say that's political, but you can also...
I think some of that is politically motivated, right? You know, I get it, right? There's an aspect of that, but...
Well, if I was arguing that it isn't, I would say that there's, whenever you put restrictions on achieving the best possible return on your investment...
That's exactly where I was going with it, too, okay. Jeff. I mean, I think the bottom line is, is this adversely impacting the results that's what the employees who participate in the pension system or the retirement plans that are available through the state or whatever those resources are that the governor is talking about.
Right.
How's the bottom line being impacted by these decisions? And ultimately, the market forces at work, right? If BlackRock isn't cutting it, people will simply choose imagine where they get better returns.
Yeah.
And in the pandemic, ESG funds that maybe had limited fossil fuel exposure did great because oil prices were down because no one was using it. And in the years, as we recover, it's been an entirely different story, right?
Right.
So, naturally that works into performance, right? So, let's continue this conversation in the next hour. We're out of time. We got a lot still to talk about as it relates to this issue. We've got the news. Stay with us. And keep in mind, if you need any help, reach out to amrfinancial.com. We'll be right back.
You're listening to Something More with Chris Boyd.
Asset Management Resources, LLC, and J. Christopher Boyd, CFP, provide investment advice on an individual basis to clients only. Proper advice depends on a complete analysis of all facts and circumstances. The information given on this program is in the nature of general financial comments and cannot be relied upon as pertaining to your specific situation. AMR, LLC, cannot guarantee that using the information from this show will generate profits or ensure freedom from loss. Listeners should consult their own financial advisors or conduct their own due diligence before making any financial decisions.